Thank you guys so much. Can everybody hear me okay? Thank you for that awesome introduction. He sure is fun, huh? Wouldn't mind having him be my warm-up guy every time. My name is Steve Bench, and I created a company called Generational Consulting. And what I speak about is talent attraction and workforce retention. And I kind of do that through the lens of generational differences. And what makes me kind of speak about these generational differences with kind of an expert tone is because I work with thousands of teenagers every single year at a nonprofit that I created called The Pitch. Raise your hand if you've seen the Shark Tank TV show. How about Price is Right game show? Homesick from school? Come on down. If you mix Shark Tank with Price is Right, you've got The Pitch. It's a business contest in a game show setting. The kids have an absolute blast. I spend a couple $100 on candy at Walmart. I let them play music all day long. They're having an absolute blast of a field trip learning how to be entrepreneurs, but they're also learning what the future workforce expects from them. And I know it's a cliche, but I learn way more from my students than I could ever teach them. And I take all of those things that I observe from this youngest generation and I put it into the keynote presentation I'm gonna give you a preview of right now. So these are my Shark Tank kids right there. But before we can even begin to understand what that young generation wants, we were just trying to wrap our minds around the millennials. So what I speak about is generational differences in talent attraction. Anybody having staffing problems right now? I mean, anywhere you go in the country, I've worked from coast to coast, everybody has a now hiring sign in their window. We are competing for talent. And this is my grandparents' generation. Because I think if you really want to understand millennials and Generation Z, that story has its roots way back past the 80s and the 90s when the millennials like me were born and came of age. My grandparents started this story, and they had a much harder life than I do as a millennial. They lived through so much more, and they saw so much sacrifice and struggling. And what came out the other end for my grandparents was that they got their identity through what they did for work. My grandma and grandpa owned a grocery store in Wisconsin. They lived for that job. First ones there in the morning, last ones there to leave. And that identity is what gave them the respect of their peers. That's how they got into the adult club. Fast forward to my baby boomer parents. By age 25, they had gotten married, bought a house, had three kids. They had put their roots down in your community by age 25. And as a result of that, they got much more serious about work and their career at a much younger age. The generation that would come next is Gen X. Any Gen Xers in the house today? Make a little bit of noise, Gen X. This is your part of the presentation. We're gonna give you a trophy for participating and make you feel special. I've been told that my keynote is like a Gen X therapy session for Gen X and baby boomer employees, so I think you'll like it. You did not have the hyper-supervised helicopter parent culture that I grew up in. Your childhood was a little bit different. You went off and you played on those summer days with no adults around. You were probably literally shoved out the screen door, told to go off and play, and you weren't to come home until, help me out, until the streetlights came on. You got it. And the last generation of American kids to have that unsupervised childhood. And it's more than just nostalgia, because think about what was happening to you on those average summer days. You were learning how to be more independent. You were learning how to be more resilient. And by the time you were 25 years old, you were much more well-equipped to roll with the punches and handle the stress and adversity that the working world and adult life is inevitably gonna throw at us. Then all of a sudden, guess who comes next? My proud millennial generation. So in my keynote session, I give you a look inside the millennial mindset and help you understand how millennials like me grew up. And just as we were starting to think about millennials, guess who's coming along next? They're already 25 years old, Generation Z. And if you thought millennials were hard to work with, just wait till their little brothers and sisters get here. They're gonna be even more disruptive than the millennials were. And one of the points I like to make when we talk about Gen Z and how Gen Z is different than the millennials, if Gen Z were in charge, one of the things that would be different is how information is held has completely changed. Back in the day, it used to be the org chart, the top-down chain of command. The person that had all the answers was the expert at the front of the room. In the classroom, you would sit there silently. I would write on the chalkboard or the dry erase board, and you copy it into your notebook. Don't make a peep. That's how information was passed along. Well, those days are over. You ask a kid today, information is all on the network. And good ideas, they come from everywhere. It's not always the expert at the front of the room that's gonna have all the answers. So one of the things I talk to my clients about is, how can you help me connect to your network? And more importantly than that, are you open to being challenged? Because when I come in and I question the process and I challenge the paradigm and I say, why do we do it this way? It's not because I'm trying to be disrespectful or insubordinate. It's because my entire life I've been rewarded by my teachers and parents and coaches for finding new ways to do old, outdated things. And I'm going to expect that to continue when I enter the workplace. So how can you help me connect to your network? And are you confident enough to be vulnerable and be open to being challenged? Because whether we're ready for them or not, this is the first fully virtual generation. And when we wanted to know the answer to a question, we didn't quietly raise our hand and wait to be called on. We just Google it. If I want to learn how to do something, I don't ask Grandpa to go teach me in the tool shed. I go on YouTube and I can find a tutorial on anything that I want. I get my news through my phone. I shop online. I get a room. I get a ride. Everything that I need goes through that phone that's in my pocket. So this generation is fully virtual and fully connected, and they are living through these social media platforms. It gives these kids a platform for self-expression that my grandparents would have never dreamed of. I have Shark Tank kids who tell me, Steve, social media, I got friends that social media is like their whole life. And when we quiz Gen Z and we ask them, what's more important, your in-person interactions or your online virtual presence? Guess what Gen Z said? Virtual presence, of course, right? And this makes my parents' generation just have smoke pouring out of their ears because this seems completely backwards to them. And whether we're ready for this generation or not, they are coming to us feeling powerful, important, and successful. And I think the reasons why they feel that way are because we now have kid-centric families in this country. The child is on a pedestal. I'm guessing that if you have kids, what you're doing this weekend probably revolves around their schedule, right? Their sports games, their activities, their birthday parties. And it gives them a tremendous sense of self-confidence. Because back in my grandpa's day, help me out now, children were to be seen and not heard, not anymore, right? That kid's up on a pedestal. And they have more knowledge than we did at the same age because they're the kids of the internet age. They've had a smartphone in their pocket their entire life. So as soon as they wondered something, all they had to do was Google it or YouTube it. And as a result of that, they might come into the workplace with a lot less experience than you did by the age of 25, but I can pretty much guarantee you that there are certain things our organizations know that we need to get better at, and those 25-year-olds that walk through the door, they might be the expert in the room at some of the things we need to get better at. Because I'll ask you right now, which generation do you think is most familiar with the technology and tools that are going to shape our future world? It ain't the baby boomers. It ain't my mom and dad. My mom was so worried about the pandemic when everything went virtual. I mean, she's doing great now. She's like a Zoom queen. She's got Zoom euchre night on Tuesdays. She does Zoom book club on Thursdays. But for a while, she said, Stevie, I'm going to have to quit my job. I can't do this. The generation that was ready to rock and roll was Gen Z. So they might walk through your door being the expert at some of the things we know that we need to get better at. So what's this really all about? Well, this affects us whether we're management professionals and we run an association. This is our staff, our peers, our volunteers. This is the people that we serve on the board, our team members. And this message in my keynote is aimed at young professionals because we're trying to attract and retain that next generation of talented employees. So in my sessions, I give you the inside look at how you can engage Generation Z and Millennials in the workplace. And one of the things I like to talk about, it's not just every generation of young kids that changes things. That's true. Every new generation, we notice certain things are different. But our entire culture, we all change every 10 years or so. It's not just the kids that change. So one of the things I like to talk about is how have we all changed over the last decade or two? And one of the things that's kind of changed things is we're now living in the smartphone age. And smartphones, for as much as they give us, they've taken a lot. Because back in the day, before smartphones came along, we used to have this old rule that we would defer to an authority figure, that we would put our faith and our trust into a higher power to tell us what to do or what to think, and we put our faith in that authority figure. Now, we don't have faith in anything. We challenge every authority figure at every turn. But back in the day, we didn't. I mean, back in the day, it was father knows best. Never question your teacher. At home, we could turn the news on, Republican or Democrat, and believe this. We could watch the news and actually believe it was the facts of what happened during the day. Now we challenge everything. It's like, gosh, you go to the doctor's office and you say, well, geez, doc, I know that you went to med school for 10 years and this is literally your life's work, but I don't know. I was on WebMD last night and I read an article and now I don't think you know what you're talking about because I'm the millennial expert who's convinced himself that he's the smartest person in the room because of that smartphone that's in my pocket. And that's the challenge. Because we challenge authority now, and at a point in time when we don't have trust in our authority figures, you're asking me to put my trust in you to come work for your organization. So how do we build up trust in those people that work for us? And I think a couple things come to mind. It's all about feedback. We've heard the stereotype that millennials need too much feedback, but feedback is the key. Your feedback is what builds my trust. And if I trust you, I'm gonna be more loyal to this job. And the more loyal that I am, the more you're gonna be able to criticize me. Because if there's a mutual trust and respect, I'm gonna be able to take what you need to tell me. I'm gonna be able to hear what I need to hear. And part of what else is going on here is there was this old rule of the workplace. This old rule that said, no news is good news. You remember this one? That if I'm your manager and you haven't heard from me, you can assume everything's fine. I'm not gonna come around once a day to try to think up some compliment to give you so that you feel good about yourself and working here, right? That's a millennial thing. We haven't been doing that for very long. But no news is good news, that's dead. Kids today, millennials, especially Gen Z, we are supervised, validated with a constant dialogue and constant feedback from our parents, our teachers, and our coaches. And we don't expect that to change when we trade our backpack for a briefcase. So how can you give me the feedback that I desire? And what I'm really here to talk about, and in my keynotes and breakout sessions, what we really talk about is how do you attract and retain those young professionals? Because I'm guessing you've heard a generational differences talk before, probably a bunch of them. But what's different about my session is I actually give you the action plan, the now what, the where do we go from here? How can we actually improve some of these relationships at the workplace to improve our bottom line? So I'll talk about a lot more in my keynote. Here's a couple quick examples today. How can you help me thrive in your organization? My parents at age 25 were at a different life stage than I am now. So you need to give me much shorter milestones, more frequent recognition, because my parents were future focused. You've got three kids under the age of 10. You're not going anywhere for like 30 years, right? So you're future focused. If you have some vesting program where after 5 years I vest into a program, well, that sounds great, but I'm on a much shorter time horizon. I also am at a different life stage. So take into account how I make my decisions. And if I'm not yet at the life stage where I have a spouse, a house, and kids, then maybe the relationships that I form with all of you at work and those emotional connections mean more to me than you realize. And that's a great way to increase our retention rates by relying on those emotional connections. Final point here, my grandpa was lucky to have his job and he acted like it. Never called in sick, never showed up late. But now hiring in every window across the country, I can go work anywhere I want. I can leave all those jobs behind and live in my parents' basement, right? I don't have to grow up yet. So we need to look at our employees, not just the young ones, but everybody, and say, we are lucky to have you here, and we're gonna treat you like it. And I'll leave this note with you today, that if you're working with young professionals, do not let the few bad ones ruin the reputation of the rest of us, because whenever you're working with Gen Z or millennials, there's gonna be a third of us that get it, a third that can be taught, and a third that's a lost cause. So just forget about Beaver, forget about Michael Phelps, and focus your energy and patience on the one third of us that wanna do things the right way. Help me get my identity through work. I'm just gonna need your help to get it done. Thank you guys so much. I'm Steve Bench.